out last night, and I went to bed thinking that I had sent it, but I hadn't. So you got it this morning. I'm sorry to confuse you, but then, I don't know what to say. I guess you're welcome. Some of you are probably used to that anyway, right? All right. Let's sing, "Thank You, Lord, for Your Blessings on Me."
Thank you. keep asking that the Lord, the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but also in the one to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way.
Let's sing a few verses of God is so good as we prepare our hearts for prayer. Remember, your Heavenly Father loves you. It's a love that is everlasting. And around you, he wraps his everlasting arms. Everlasting means it's not going away. Would you just think about his goodness? About the great love he has for you, and bring whatever it is, whatever care, whatever burden, distraction, frustration, whatever is disturbing your peace, bring it to Jesus. He's already paid for it. It's the things that were nailed to the cross with him. You ready to sing, and then we'll pray. Healing and restoration and life instead of death and condemnation. You speak when we are in prison of our sins, Lord, you speak. You spoke to us peace, and you still speak to us peace.
Oh, Jesus, we want you. We want you today to have your way with us, Lord, and in us and through us. And Lord, we want you to have all of us. And we want all of us to be for you. Show us the way. Show us how to surrender and let go. Just be yielded to you. Now, Lord, for you people here today, Lord, in the weariness, and Lord, we look around, we know a lot of people are sick or traveling or preparing for the holiday. But Lord, we're here because we love you. We pray for our brothers and sisters because we love them too. Lord, give us a touch from you. Give us strength. Help us to see you again. Open the eyes of our hearts, Lord. We want to see you. Lord, would you take us in your hands and break us like you broke the bread at the supper and share us with the world so that the world would know you, Lord. So they would be nourished by the same love and life that you've nourished us. We ask this in Jesus' name and for his sake. And all God's people said,
we're going to sing together the beautiful song. the Council of Jerusalem what happened. So Peter basically repeats the story that of what happened in chapter 10. He repeats that in chapter 11. One of the things that Jewish people weren't really good at. I'm sorry. Yes, sir.
Psalmist says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. All I think, all I have, all I know, all I feel, Lord, I'm going to submit that to your authority, and you're going to be Lord of what I think, what I feel, what I say. Even when I'm tired, even when I'm frustrated, even when I'm angry, even when I'm count on your goodness and your peace and your power more than what I'm feeling. Amen. You have that privilege, sir, ma'am, because you're a child of God. If you're born again, you have that privilege to take whatever you're feeling and thinking and put it to the Lord and say, this is what's going on today, Lord, but we also often use that but in a different, that word but in a different way. We say, God's good and God is with us, but no. Start with, this is what I'm feeling, but God is good and God is right and God is holy and God is true and God is all powerful, and let God have the last word. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Let God, and what he says, have the last word. If you start with God said but, then you start in the light and you start walking towards the darkness. But in your conversation, start with the dark problem and bring it to the light. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is.
Psalms, they don't start with light and turn to darkness. They start with the problem and turn to God. Yeah, that's the right way. That's the right way. Well, I don't know how to kick that over. But bless the Lord, oh my soul. Caesarea, where this man, this Roman centurion, he was an officer of a 100 Roman soldiers. So he's quite an important officer. It's about 68 kilometers, about a 12 and a half or 13 hour walk. So you get a sense of how long it would take the people that were coming from Cornelius' house to see Peter and Joppa, how long it would take them. While he's in Joppa, he's preaching and praying and doing the work of the Lord, another man a few days' journey in those days up the coast in Caesarea, this Roman named Cornelius, he's a man who wants to serve God, wants to know God, and he had contributed to the building of a synagogue. He knew and understood there's something real about this God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He was fasting and praying. He was a devout man. And while he's fasting and praying, a vision from the Lord comes and says, there's a man named Peter. He's in Joppa. He's at the house of Simon the Tanner. So go find Simon Peter in the house of Simon the Tanner. And he sent people. Now we know that it was a journey, because when Peter arrives at Cornelius' house, Cornelius tells Peter, it was 4 days ago and I had this vision. So he sends his servants to go find Peter and bring him back. The Lord doesn't tell us in the scripture what Peter was doing, but it tells us about the time that the messengers from Cornelius got to the house of Simon the Tanner. Peter was upstairs on the roof, the flat roof. He was meditating. He was praying. And he has this vision. Now, for me, this vision wouldn't work, because I grew up a missionary's kid, and I ate everything. I didn't say no. And I liked most all of it. Actually, I have to back that up. I did say no to snails. But I tried just about everything else. Now, Peter's vision, there was in this big sheet, animals came down that the law said you were not supposed to eat, like pigs and creeping animals. Like, the law said you couldn't eat lizards. All kinds of things. And the voice from heaven said, Simon, rise, kill, and eat. Because Simon was hungry. He was on the roof praying because they were cooking dinner, preparing dinner. He thought, I'll go pray and fast and meditate until dinner time. So he's up there, and the Lord presents him food, and he says, rise, kill, and eat. He says, Lord, not so. I've never had anything that was like that was common. What does it mean when he says common? He's saying, Lord, I have been a good Jew from before I was aware of myself. When I was born, I was marked as a part of your covenant between the living God and a good Jewish man. I've kept myself in every way I can for you. And this is something, Lord, that I can't do. It's against the law that you gave to Moses. I know this. It was such an ingrained tradition that you just wouldn't consider it. A voice comes from heaven and says, rise, kill, and eat. And he says, not so, Lord. No. This happened 3 times. Think about the challenge that God was giving to Peter. Peter, you're going to have to think in a new way about yourself, my world, and how you interact with it. At the last time this happened, the Lord tells Peter, there's men at the door, coming to the door. They're going to want you to go with them to see this man named Cornelius. Verse 19 of chapter 10. Simon, 3 men are looking for you. So get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate. Do not hesitate to go with them. Now, he had hesitated on the roof, right? Remember who this guy is. Peter is the guy who was filled with joy and touched by the Holy Spirit, revealed to him to say to Jesus, you are the Lord, the Christ, the Son of the living God, and almost in the next breath said, when Jesus said, okay, well, I'm going to go and die on a cross, he said, no, Lord, not you. That's not going to happen. Come here, we're going to talk about this now. You need to get this straight. You're not going to a cross and you're not dying. That's not the way Messiah works. And what did Jesus say to him? Does anybody remember? Talk to people and impress them to make them feel good about us. But that's what Jesus said. Get thee behind me, Satan. You do not discern the ways of God. Peter learned a lesson that day. Or started learning a lesson. It wasn't long after that, when Jesus surrendered himself to arrest, Peter was the one that whipped out his sword. And he wasn't just trying to intimidate people with his sword. He went for the guy's head, got his ear. That tells us that Peter was ready to kill. was not a surprise that the Lord had to convince Peter. It tells him three times. By the way, the repetition three times is important in the scripture. What do the angels who surround the throne say about Jesus, about the one sitting on the throne? Holy, 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 the thrice holy God. God tells Peter three times, it's confirmed. Okay, Peter, something's changing. Now these guys who are coming, don't hesitate. Now the scripture does not tell us that they are Romans. Peter goes down in verse 21 and says, I'm the one you're looking for. Well, I've come. The Lord told me, right? They're looking for him. And they said, we have come from Cornelius the centurion. That would have been a problem for Peter because he was a Roman officer. Not just because he was a Roman, but he was a Roman officer. He was one of the occupiers. He's a righteous man and God-fearing. Like you Romans know what God-fearing is. Peter just listened. He was respected by all the Jewish people. A holy angel told him to ask you to come to his house. Wait a minute. A Jewish man going in the house of a Roman. Those houses had idols in them. Roman houses. Peter didn't know he didn't have idols. He knew that the Lord had said, don't hesitate, and he did not. The next day he goes, he invites these messengers from the Roman centurion, probably Gentiles themselves. Oh, they're not God's people. They're not the chosen people. Peter said, I already had this discussion with Jesus. I'm one of the chosen people. But God said, don't call profane or common what I have called holy. He invites them to stay in the house. They presumably sit down and enjoy a meal together. The next day he goes to Cornelius' house. When he walks in the door, Cornelius bows before him in reverence at his feet. Peter says, this is verse 16 of chapter 10. Stand up, I'm only a man myself. When he went inside the house, he found a large gathering of people. Doesn't give us a number, but it's a large gathering. I would guess it's similar to the gathering of the day of Pentecost. It doesn't tell us it was the same number, but it may have been near that number. And he says, you're well aware that it's against our Jewish law to associate with or visit Gentiles. But God has shown me that I should not call anyone impure or unclean. That's verse 28. Verse 29, so when I was sent for, I came without raising an objection. And I asked why you sent for me. And then Cornelius tells the story of how he had this vision and he was commanded to send somebody for Peter. Peter begins to preach to him. Peter begins to tell the people in Cornelius' house, listen to what he says. This is verse, if you want to follow along, chapter 10, verse 34. We are going to get to Acts 11, 15 through 18 in a minute. This is the back story. Verse 34. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. You know that the message of God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what happened through the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing it good and healing all who were under the power of the devil because God was with him. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. And they killed him by hanging him on a cross. But God raised him up from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God chose, who had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God has appointed as judge of the living and the dead. And all the prophets testify about him. And everyone who believes in his name receives forgiveness through sins. languages they didn't know, but they didn't just do that. They let themselves out, or the Lord let them out of jail, but it looked like they let themselves out of jail. They were healing a people that were obviously never going to get better, like the lame man by the gate, beautiful. He went walking and leaping and praising God. These things, these signs, these actions by the Holy Spirit were marking God's people out. Now the Holy Spirit shows up and does the same thing to a bunch of outsiders, to a bunch of Gentiles. I don't know. It may have been like this. Okay, Peter, you said enough. Stop. I got to say something now. And the Holy Spirit confirmed everything Peter had witnessed to and confirmed the faith of this faithful Roman centurion. A man, Roman soldiers were trained in the art of war. They knew how to hurt people. They knew how to kill them lethally. He was not the kind of person that we would have chosen to begin the quote-unquote Gentile church. Chosen him and picked him. He wasn't in our plan. He would not have been in our plan. A person like him would not fit well with us. But the Holy Spirit didn't listen to our plans and our committees and our ideas and our... Get where I'm going with this? You get where the Lord is going with this? If you drive around Amish country, blinders on horses. So they don't see too much. Now the Holy Spirit does the opposite. We put the blinders on and we say, this is what we have seen and this is what we want because this works for us. And the Holy Spirit says, I have known you, I have bought you with my own blood, you are mine, and I know what you need. But Lord, we are stuck on the roof with Peter going, not so, Lord. That isn't the way it works, Lord. God help us. These people are filled with the Spirit, and they are baptized, and they come apart in the name of Jesus Christ. They become a part of the church. So Peter goes back to Jerusalem, and he is in trouble. Why did you go and meet with Gentiles? Now, Peter, you have to face the music. Peter tells a story, the one I just told you. Now let's get to Acts 11, 15 through 18. The way the church responds to Peter's witness and the Holy Spirit's confirmation of Peter's witness. It wasn't just what Peter said. It's what the Holy Spirit did. He moved Peter and he moved Cornelius together. He talked to Cornelius and said, do this. And while it was happening, he said, okay, Peter, get ready. I got something for you to do. There's people coming. Don't you dare. Don't you dare call them unholy. Let's read verse 11. We're in verse 15, chapter 11. I get confused sometimes. Did I confuse you? Sorry, let's read verse 15. As I begin to speak, says Peter, he planned the same order, didn't he? The Holy Spirit interrupted him. As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came on them, and he has come on us at the beginning. Then I remembered what the Lord had said. John baptized you with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. So if God gave them the same gift he gave us, who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to think that I could stand in God's way? Now this is the congregation, the conference, the board meeting that was ready to discipline Peter, I think. When they heard this, they had no further objection and praised God, saying, so then even to the Gentiles, God has granted repentance that leads to life. What made this upon this rock, I will build my church. And when did the church happen? When the Holy Spirit showed up and breathed on those men and women. There were 120 in the upper room. They were praying, and there came the sound of a great, mighty, rushing wind. It caught them like something like wind does to a sail on a sailboat. Or if you walked outdoors on a particularly brisk morning and that wind hits you in the face and you go, you catch your breath. The Spirit moved on them and something happened. That visible fire, that flame of fire, is really important. Because we have recorded in the book of Kings that when Solomon had finished building the temple and dedicated the temple, and they were ready to send the priest in. God's presence was so thick that the priest couldn't go in. He so much occupied that space in the temple, and something else happened. God himself, by his own hand, started the fire, the holy fire, on the altar. That's God saying, that's my place. I'm accepting the temple that you have built for me, but this is something different. You see, we didn't make humanity. God made humanity. God made human beings. And Stephen's already told us a few chapters earlier that God doesn't dwell in temples made with hands, but he dwells in human beings. This is the temple. So the same holy God that lit the fire on Solomon's temple, this beautiful temple, probably the most expensive building ever built. Now these fishermen and tax collectors, former prostitutes, people who had been demon-possessed, are in an upper room praying, and God lights them up with the same fire that he lit the altar in Solomon's temple, and they walk out with holy fire. And then he does the same thing. The same thing. Idol worshippers, a debauched Roman. How in the world could God do that? How would God can't use? Don't tell God what he can't do. Don't fool yourself into thinking that you can tell God anything. You can tell God your burdens. You can tell God your heartaches. You can bring those to him. But to let him go and let God. We said that at the beginning, right? Let God have the final word. And he did. He did and he does. There's one thing, get this, one thing that we must have, one thing and one thing only that we must have to be the Church of Jesus Christ. You know what it is? Is that the Bible? Something beyond faith. It's a someone. It's not good music. It's not right beliefs. Makes the Church of Jesus Christ the Church of Jesus Christ. Yeah, but what if we get off track? It's his job to keep us on track. What about heretics and wrong beliefs? It's his job. But what about sin in the church? It's his job. You go read about those seven churches in the book of Revelation. The Holy Spirit speaks to each one of them. Remember the day it dawned on me. I felt like I got off the hook as a preacher. You know what? Jeff, if people ain't going to listen to the Holy Spirit, there's nothing you can say that's going to change their minds, because he is the most persuasive and powerful individual in the universe. It's God, right? It's God. I don't have to keep people right. I have to keep step with the Holy Spirit. I have to not get in his way. More often than not means I need to keep my mouth shut. And if I have something to say it to the Lord in the place of prayer. Amen. Prayer is giving yourself to God. Surrendering yourself to the Holy Spirit. It is talking and it is listening. One of the problems is we think that we have made up the church. The church is made up of us. We are the people. We the people have made a church. No. The Holy Spirit has made a church. And he's invited you to join what he's doing. If we're reconstituting the republic, we can start with we the people. But in the church, we start with by the Spirit. in the name of Jesus Christ, according to the will of the Father. That's the way. That's the way. That's the way. Thinking for a minute about the things that we've decided are so vital to the church and its health and to its future. And how many of those are anchored and centered in the Holy Spirit? Or how many of those are anchored and centered in pop culture and responding to what the world says? You know what? We don't have to respond to what the world says. The gospel of Jesus Christ was before the world and before sin because he's the Lamb slain. The Holy Spirit has always known what the world was going to think, what the world was going to do, what the world was going to say. And if we keep step with him, we do not have to react. You might be shocked, but you don't have to react. What are the things that we must have? Come to the realization, Jeff Lemire, that the church will survive without you. Yes, you can put your name in there too. The church will survive without us, but it must have the Holy Spirit. We must have the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of truth that he promised, his gift. This Holy Spirit, he's the Spirit of Jesus Christ, the one who said, I will send you another comforter. Jesus is what we call him the Word. He is, Hebrews refers to him as the Word of God's power by which everything is sustained. Sustaining all things by the Word of his power, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. The Holy Spirit is the breath of God that makes life and dead hearts and dead minds and dead spirits and bodies. And those of us who are dead in our trespasses and sins. So on the day of Pentecost, and on the day of this Gentile Pentecost, guess what they didn't have? Didn't have a program. And they didn't have a seminary-trained clergyman. They did not have an order of worship. They didn't even have a Bible. How could they have a church without a Bible? There wasn't denominations or districts or disciplines or boards. There weren't committees to plan the event. There was no ushers. There was no even an offering to receive. How could you have a church without an offering? There's no worship team, song leaders. There's no greeters. There was no social hour afterwards. I like social hour, but it wasn't planned. They didn't have announcements. They had a mighty rush of God's Spirit igniting the Shekinah fire on God's chosen temple, the human soul. It says the church of Jesus Christ was a possession of the Holy Spirit, and it was the church of Jesus Christ, and it had the gospel, and it had life, and it had everything it needed. And it has everything it needs today. When I meditated about this the other night, I remember the church of Laodicea in Revelation chapter 3. They said, we're rich. We're increased with goods. We have need of nothing. And the Lord says, you are naked, and you are blind, and you are destitute. Wake up! Wake up! And then he said something that is once tragic and wonderful. He says, I stand, he's talking to his church. I stand at the door and knock to his church and to his people. Anyone who hears and opens, I will come in. The Holy Spirit will come in and make home with you. The one essential is the Holy Spirit. The one universal thing that we have. One message. Jesus died for sinners like me. God made him who knew no sin to be sin for me, that you and I, and for you, that you and I might be the righteousness of God in him. That's our message. It's the gospel. So by the Spirit, Jesus comes on the inside of us, not just on the outside, but on the inside, and makes home with us, and does this forever. And the Holy Spirit does what Jesus but it is the Holy Spirit that does that. He builds it in you, and he builds it with you. He builds the character and the likeness of God your Father in Christ Jesus in you, and he puts God's people together so we are the church of Jesus Christ. Not according to our discipline or our rules or our way of doing things, but according to his will. According to his love. According to his holy nature. Something I can't conjure, I can't make, I can't fake, but he can do in me and he can do in you. And you will. He will. He will. So if the Holy Spirit does the will of God, he is not fulfilling my ambitions or my plans, or our ambitions, our plans. Only when we make the Holy Spirit the one essential in our needs and in our church, that's when we really get to be the body of Christ. We'll be united to Christ and be united in Christ. So how badly do you need the Holy Spirit today? I would like to lay on the sea and say, yeah, you know, spiritually, that's pretty good. I'm all right. I don't have a lot of things I'm guilty over. Sometimes I feel bad, but I'm not really guilty. Is the power and the presence of God working in your life? Do other people see the power and presence of God working in your life? Do they feel God loving them when they're near you? For your spiritual existence, how much do you need the Holy Spirit? Or is he just kind of an add-on? He's like when you sit down at the table, right, for lunch at a restaurant, you hope there's a bottle of ketchup. You can do without it, but you hope there's a bottle. No, the Holy Spirit is the bottle of ketchup to your fast food menu, the fast food menu. He is the essential. He is the breath of God, and he's the breath you breathe if you're a child of God. Maybe you didn't know it. Well, brother and sister, wake up. Wake up, because he is the assurance of your salvation and your peace with God. Here's another question for you. Is there some value, something you value highly, or a religious practice that you need to yield and let go so that the Holy Spirit can take that space and do something that he decided to do with it, not just what you decided to do with it? Is there something the Holy Spirit has put his finger on your heart and your mind and say, but no, Lord, not so. That's so contrary to my tradition and my way of thinking. And you'll hear the voice of God gently say, it's not your way of thinking, it's my way of thinking, and you are mine. What do you have to say to that, my friend? The Father says, what do you have to say to that, my child? Father, may I admonish you to let nothing come between you and the Holy Spirit. Let nothing separate you. He won't. He will hound you to the day that your life on this earth ends, because he wants you that much and he loves you that much. What will you allow? I was talking to the kids a couple Wednesdays ago in chapel. I started singing that song from that dumb Disney video, Let It Go, Let It Go. You don't consumed